Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to be starting, so if you can please take your seats. And if we ask that you please just try to move towards the center of the aisles, just make it easier for other people to take their seats, please. My name is Barry Brudney. I'm a first-year MBA student at MIT Sloan, and it's my pleasure to be able to present our two speakers for today, Chris Collinsworth, an NBC sportscaster, and Neil Hornsby, the founder of Pro Football Focus, for their presentation, Player Grades, the Competitive Advantage in Football Performance. So it's all you guys.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for filling up the room, too. I was afraid Neil and I are going to be in here talking to ourselves. We do that a lot anymore. But it's a great honor. People said, well, why did you come here? And I was like, oh, how many times in your life does somebody from MIT call and say, well, you want to speak to our guys? I mean, for an old football player who's had a couple of concussions along the way, this is a pretty good thing. And one of the things that I was really excited about coming here to do, because we just left the combine, and we were up there with all the teams that we're now dealing with. We have 25 teams. We think that's going to be 28 or 30 NFL teams that we're working with. And only one coach, I think, in the entire way. We probably met with 20 teams. One wave after another of 25 to 35-year-olds are coming through there. And these data analysts are now making decisions in the National Football League that used to be left to these crusty old coaches and people like me that have been around the game for 400 years. And the NFL now is finally catching up to what baseball has known, what we've seen the NBA doing lately, what we're seeing hockey do now, what soccer has been doing. And it's been an unbelievable sort of flash flood in the last 4 or 5 years. And so the one message that I want to start with today is that there isn't a single person in this room that couldn't have something to do with the National Football League or the NCAA or game planning or having an impact on who wins and loses football games. We have 300 to 350, whatever it may be, people now, most of whom have never played football, that are now having a direct impact on 25 of our team customers. It's about the math. It's about this generation that's no longer afraid of anything digital, of any sort of number crunching, guys that used and girls that used to go to Wall Street and do financial stuff. And that's a horrible life. Don't do that. It's like you sleep for 3 hours a week and it's horrible. I wake up, Neil wakes up every day. We've never worked a day in our lives. We're going in to do football every single day. And so I had to come meet some of the people that I know are going to be the future of the National Football League because we've seen it. We know exactly where this thing's going, and we hope we're on the front end of it. I want to start, just so you have some idea of what Pro Football Focus is, maybe if we could show the videotape and we can give some idea of what we are.
With Alex Beth. That information coming to you from the world headquarters of Pro Football Focus.
As you take a look at Derek Carr, Pro Football Focus, Rich has him as the number 4 quarterback in the NFL.
Go to Pro Football Focus.
And I'm going to tell you, I know the answer because I went to Pro Football Focus to find it, all right?
Pro Football Focus grades every single player in the NFL.
But as we look inside some of the numbers of Pro Football Focus.
My good friends at Pro Football Focus.
Here's your quick release last season, according to Pro Football Focus.
Who is Pro Football Focus? I don't even know.
Every game, every player, every play, we give you insights you simply can't get anywhere else.
Carson Palmer, USC.
David Johnson, Northern Iowa.
PFF position ranks where they rank at their position, according to the great site, Pro Football Focus.
And Rodgers is starting this year, 30th in completion percentage, 31st in yards per pass, and is Pro Football Focus's lowest graded quarterback.
Because people come to the big lead and they make excuses for Rodgers. It's the offensive line. Well, no, Pro Football Focus says they've got a top 5 line.
Now you're looking at whatever you guys are looking at to break down the performances. I don't know if you guys are doing the Pro Football Focus.
Listen, Pro Football Focus has rated number 2 quarterback in the National Football League right now. Today, he's named a first-team All-American by Pro Football Focus.
Junior named Pro Football Focus best offensive lineman in college football.
best pass protecting group in the NFL, according to Pro Football Focus.
They know everything. They see all. They know all. So I give it up to Pro Football Focus.
So of all those guys, the only one I had to pay money under the table to was Al Michaels. But that's a totally, totally different kind of story. This gentleman next to me has one of the more incredible stories that I've ever heard. I'll tell you how I met him. I was supposed to do a post-game show for NBC. I was like, well, that's a brilliant idea, guys. I don't watch any of the other games all day. I'm doing work, getting ready for this game. But what the heck? So I go on the, I can cheat, I can figure out something. So I go online and I start pecking around. I've got to find somebody who's watched all the games and could give me something, because I can talk around things, right? You give me a little nugget, I can mess around. I can make it sound like I know what I'm talking about out there. So I found this Pro Football Focus, and they had these color-coded depth charts. And I started going down the list of some of the teams of the games that I had just done. And it was the Cowboys and the Giants and blah, blah, blah. So I'm going down this list, and I'm looking, and I'm like, I go, hey, this is pretty good. You know, he says he's no good. That's, this is pretty good. So then they had this thing, you could get more of it for $26.99. Okay, well, here's my credit card. I put it in, $26.99. And here comes some more stuff. And it was, hey, this is pretty good. Who are these guys? This must be a bunch of coaches. I have no idea who these guys are. So you know that little contact us thing in the upper right-hand corner, that whole thing? So I type in there, hi, this is Chris Collinsworth. I work for NBC. And I was wondering, who are you guys? And, you know, blah, I paid $26 for this thing. And, you know, and here's my phone number. So about 3.5 minutes later, I get this call from an international line, and this guy with a British accent comes on, and he goes, hello, I can't do a British accent. This is Neil Hornsby, and you know, I'm from Pro Football Focus. And the only thing that crossed my mind at all was, son of a gun. I said, I just got hustled out of $26. I can't believe it. This Brit's got me for $26. So I said, this is not going to last long. I start firing questions at this guy about the left guard and the safety and the special teams cover guys and all these things. And he's firing answers back at me faster than I can think up questions. And after about 4 minutes, I gave up. I was like, who are you? What is this whole thing all about? And he starts telling me the story of this company that started as a bunch of guys online in Great Britain that watched one Dan Marino game and fell in love with the data and this. I was like, you gotta be kidding me. And my wife, about 6 years earlier, we were doing the Super Bowl in Indianapolis. I'm driving up, and she's reading me the Wall Street Journal. She's really great to me. So she's reading me this stuff. So as I'm going along, she goes, oh, look at this. They got a story about the Super Bowl on the front page. And it was blah, blah, blah. And the New York Giants are saying their secret weapon, their secret sauce is this British guy who is Pro Football Focus, and he's given them all, and they went on to the Super Bowl. And that year they went on to beat the Patriots in the Super Bowl in Indianapolis. And it was an unbelievable news story. And so this guy started becoming world famous. My wife said, you should put that on TV. I said, I am not putting on stupid Brit having some input on the National Football League. About 4 years later, I bought the company. So it's a very small world out there. I want to give you some idea. They say, well, how can you grade the games? How can you understand? You don't understand the scheme. You don't know what you're doing. Let's do a little breakdown of what happens on one play in the Super Bowl and how Pro Football Focus and this team of 350 analysts figure out who really is the best of the players in the NFL. Or we don't really have to. We could just, there we go.
There we go.
Do you guys ever watch Johnny Carson? Dun, 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 dun,
dun, dun, dun. There we go.
There we go.
In the third quarter of the Super Bowl, the Seahawks had 1st and 10 at the New England 18.
Lynch still going to the 4. He's just a runaway truck.
On the stat line, Lynch picked up 14 yards. Rob Ninkovich made the tackle.
But what really happened during the play? Who did what and how well? Here's how we broke it down. At the line of scrimmage, the Seahawks dominated. Carpenter gets a good seal on Saliga. Tukuwafu ties up two Patriots at the point of attack. Every Seattle blocker here gets a positive grade. The Patriots are on the other side of the coin. Hightower gets cut. Collins comes in to fill but misses the tackle. And so does big Vince Wilfork and Devin McCourty. Not helping at all is Brandon Browner. He lost leverage and gets put on his back by Lockett. And Marshawn Lynch, in addition to the yardage, he's picked up 2.5 scores and a Seahawks first and goal.
So without further ado, I want to introduce you to a guy that is proof positive that dreams come true, insane stories happen, and in this crazy world, in this new world of data analytics, anything is possible, and any of you sitting in the room right now could be a part of hopefully our company or the National Football League or sports in general. It is that time. It is that time when this thing is moving so rapidly in that direction. If you've ever thought about a career path, this is one you should think about, and this is a guy you need to know. My Brit, my buddy, Neil Hornsby.
So what I'm going to do now is the techie part that goes on from that. So the grades, as you've just seen them being created, are really a blunt instrument to get to how good a player is, and I'll explain that in a minute. But they are a very, very good tool for both people in the National Football League, people in college, people in the media. I don't believe that Chris would have kept any of his hair at all this season if he hadn't been able to have our raw grades. And what we do with those raw grades, the grades that you've just seen being created, is we can create point of attack tapes for every single player in the National Football League, every single player at the FBS level. And those are obviously crucial to getting to the nub of what that player is more quickly. So Chris will get every Monday morning from us, he's got whatever game he's got the next week, he will get a point of attack tape on every single player. And that's built from those raw grades. We're not trying to say at that stage how good they are. We're letting Chris make up his own mind and we'll give him a grade as well. And that's not just being done by Chris, that's being done by teams across the National Football League. So that's fine. But they are, in terms of getting to what the player is, a fairly blunt instrument. And the reason I say that is because there's so much else involved. And I'm just going to scrape the surface by giving you a few examples of the types of things that we take into account when we take those raw grades and turn them into a player grade, the grades that you've seen on the tape. So, for example, and this is just a very, very trivial example, if a player or if a tackle gives up sort of 30 equivalent quarterback disruptions in 450 pass blocks or 550 pass blocks, is that better? What's the number of opportunities to get that? You know, people count sacks, people count many things, but the most obvious thing to do is to say then, well, how many opportunities did he have to get that? But it goes even deeper than that. What's the quality of the opportunity? What's the quality like of that snap? How much chance did he have to get a grade? So, for example, and in that trivial example, here's two players. One who faced 450 pass blocks and one who faced 550. David Bakhtiari, pass blocking for Aaron Rodgers, faced 450, but because Aaron Rodgers' average time to throw is so much greater than Drew Brees with Teron Armstrong blocking for him, then the actual time on those 450 pass blocks was actually longer than the 550 pass blocks. So even when you think you know, well, you know you don't. So you need to go on to the next stage. And let's try and get onto that in a little bit of more detail. So when we talk about the variables of opportunity. What's the time to, for example, with a quarterback, What's the time to throw? What's the step drop? I always go back to when we started looking at the grades and we used to just divide by the number of pass blocks. We were looking at this and thinking, Cincinnati's rated higher than they should be. Carolina isn't rated, you know, you just get a good feel on some of this stuff. And then you look at it and you say, well, that's because somebody like Cam Newton will hold onto the ball significantly longer than Andy Dalton. So you have to take that into account. You just have to. Then you get into things like, well, how much help were they getting? Was that tackle on an island? Were they getting help? Were they getting chips? Were they getting slide protection? Were they sliding away? You've got to take all those things into account to get to the number of the argument, the grade. What was the down and distance? What was the technique of the opposition rusher? All of these things affect the quality of the opportunity. So the way that we do it, let's take an example of a pass rusher and I'll try and get into it in a little bit of detail for you. So what we do is we have, for every single player, the NFL and the FBS level, we have a raw grade. But we also have a normalization factor. How did that player look when you compare them to the average? So for example, that normalization factor is built on a whole host of things. I'll try and get into that in a little bit more detail. But it's all based on the quality of the opportunity. And I'll come to that, as I said, in more detail. And then we sum all of those to get to a player grade, or in fact, not a player grade, but we get to the pass rush grade. So let's go through some of those things. So for example, if you are a pass rusher and you were going against a team that does a ton of screens and rollouts, you can see here that the opportunity to get pressure on a screen, and this is from our data set that goes back 10 years, the opportunity to get pressure on a screen is significantly limited. The opportunity to get pressure on a rollout, or the opportunity to get a grade on a rollout, is significantly limited. So we take those out of our normalization set. This is interesting. Techniques are where the player lines up, where the defensive player lines up. Zero tech's the nose tackle. And as you go all the way out to wide nine technique outside the tight end. And as you can see, as you get further and further away from the center, the opportunity to get pressure goes up. Why does that matter? Well, there's a player called Justin Tuck, who I'm sure some of you are familiar with, who would rush from the outside on first downs, but on second and third, or on third and long, would come inside. If we were normalizing Justin Tuck the same way we normalized everybody and not taking into account the quality of the opportunity, then his performance would be negatively affected. So we take that into account. What else do we take into account? Step drop. This is a fantastic chart. I like it when it goes like that. It always does well. So this is the step drop of the quarterback. And this is the chance to get pressure by step drop. So an average quarterback, well, I'll come on to why it's important in a minute, but a quarterback will be told, if you're on a 7-step drop, you want to be at 10 yards. And why do you want to be at 10 yards? Because the tackle is being told to take that defensive end to 11 yards. So if you're at 11 yards and you get sacked, the offensive line coach is saying it's your fault. Your fault. Get over it. But if you were going against a quarterback like Andrew Luck, who takes more 7-step drops than anybody else, you've got a significantly higher chance to get pressure than you would if you were, say, playing Blake Bortles in the Jed Fish era when he was taking a ton of 3-step drops and a ton of rollouts and a ton of screens. So just moving on again, down and distance. Why is that important? Well, on first and second downs, you'll have a pass rusher will have significantly more responsibility for playing the run. On third and long, they've got next to no responsibility for playing the run. So if you're a guy who only comes in on third down, you're a situational substitute, you have a much, much better chance of getting pressure on average than a guy like Terrell Suggs, who has to play first and second down, at where he's got much more run defense responsibility. Again, we go on. Fatigue. So I've given you a lot of things that matter. Here's something that probably doesn't matter as much. So we were interested in what is the chance of getting pressure by pass rush attempt. And as you can see, there's a lot of noise in this particular graph. It doesn't really seem to paint any picture at all over 10 years worth of data that says if you're having to rush 20 times, it's worse than having to rush 3 times. So we take this out of the equation. And by the way, I just want to say thank you to Nathan Yankee, who's in the room, who did all this for me, because I'm not that smart. He does all my good work. So that's an example of what we take into account. So when we're looking at a player like Brandon Graham, a player who didn't get that many sacks this year, a player that some people overlook, then we look and we say all of those things need to be taken into account in how we account for him as a pass rusher. So type of passes, you know, the step drop of the quarterback that he faced on each play, what the down and distance was, and all of those things we're taking into account now. What I would say, though, is we're always looking to improve. It's really important that we get better. So I'm, I did physics at university, and if the one thing I got out of it was a scientific bent. So we're always trying to break our own equations. We're always trying to say, how do we take what we do? Is it good enough? I was talking to one of the player personnel guys for one of the teams, and his point was, yes, but the thing you don't take into account is the difficulty of the opportunity, so the difficulty of the assignment we're giving the player. What's the difficulty? If a guy has a particular sort of block and he's asked to make that block more frequently than this other guy that we don't trust to make that, then you're not really taking that into account. My response to him was, you're right, but we are going to. So in 2017, we're just rolling out our new process for 2017, which we call in all blocking. So on every single play in the NFL, we'll say who a guy matched up against, what type of block they had, where the location of that block was, how well they did it, the pass rush move they went against, all of that data. We did it for two or three teams last year. We proved the concept, and now we'll look at that. So when I sit with that particular player personnel guy next year at the combine, I'll say, do you know, we'll prove it one way or the other. Either it did matter or it didn't matter, because we'll look at every hinge block and we'll say, when a guy's making this particular block, every single type of post block, what is the chances? How difficult is that based on the subset of the entire league? How difficult is it? And we'll be able to say either yes or no. I don't know the answer, truthfully. I don't know whether it'll make a difference, but we're damn well going to find out. That's for sure. You know, so all of those things are important in what we do to come to the player grades. That's the level of detail that we're prepared to take it to get to the answer that we feel comfortable with. A lot of people will say, and it's been said many times, oh, but you don't know the assignment, you don't know the player call, and you know. Well, you can hear it from me as many times as you want. You probably won't believe me. So I'll hand over to Paul Alexander, who would have been with us today, but he's at the Combine. Paul's the, I think he's the longest tenured offensive line coach in the NFL.
My name's Paul Alexander. I'm the offensive line coach of the Cincinnati Bengals. I coach the big fat guys, guys I like, and my job is to try to make them be the best players they can be. We're always looking for an edge, we're always looking for information. Everything is absolutely so competitive that the very little pieces of information that you can get make a significant difference. For example, this year I looked at all the negative plays on each of my individual players, and at the point in the season, I think we were at about 600 plays. We were two-thirds of the way through the season. I looked at all those plays, and I disagreed with maybe a dozen plays, which is pretty remarkable over the course of 600 plays. The first thing I do is I look at the grades, and I see who their best players are. you know, and it's production grades. It's not grades based on what the guy's going to be or his skill or his ability, or is the guy effective or not. And if there's a certain guy on defense, for example, that is near the quarterback a lot, then he's a problem. And I'll look at those players first, and I'll just work down the list. I'll say, okay, I think I know how to block this guy. And if I don't, then I go back and I find with the grades and matchups to find a guy who did. So my take is, yeah, you're gonna have disagreements, you're gonna miss grades, but the percentage is small, and over the big set of data, it's not significant statistically. So I think the grades are very, very close to what the players are, and I use them and I like them.
So that's Paul, and the key thing that he said during that presentation is of 600 negatively graded players that he took for his players, he disagreed with about 12. We don't know the assignment. I'm not sure you mathematicians can tell me what the inaccuracy on that is, but all I know is it's not very big. So that's where we are. So where are we going in the future? We're still moving forward, and our goal is to be able to answer any question about football. We will, we're well on our way to doing that, and we're well on our way to doing that with a tool that we're building currently, and we demonstrated it to our NFL team customers at the Combine. It's called PFF Ultimate, and it basically allows you to very simply ask any question about football that you want to. Who's the best quarterback against cover two on second down at any particular down and distance? And then visualize that answer in whatever way you wanted, whether to send it to video, whether to send it to NGS data to visualize it, whether to look at it in a chart or a graph or do whatever you want. So that's where we're going to be at some stage in the near future, some stage this year, hopefully. If you've, I don't know, Chris, if you want to say anything else, if there's anything you want to go on from there, or should we let these good people ask questions?
Yeah, no, just if you could drop your resumes off up here, I'd love to, because, I mean, you can imagine the math behind this stuff. Nathan's sitting right there, and he's the one that ends up having to do most of this stuff. But how do you compare, even if you have the grades, it's sort of a ranking, right? So on Sunday Night Football, you saw a little bit of it on the tape. At the bottom of the screen, when we do the introductions, it says, it used to say his grade was 84. Okay, what does 84 mean? Nobody knew. I said, let's do it differently. Let's rank these guys. Let's say that that guy is number 4 of 100 cornerbacks out there, which is fine. Then they all love us. But when we say that guy is number 117 of 117, a lot of big guys come looking for me. And I said, I didn't do it. Nathan and Neil did the thing. So, but now, all right, so by position, no problem. We can put them in order. Now how do you rank them when you're comparing a guard to a safety to a wide receiver? And now the mathematicians have to take over. Now you have to start figuring out formulas that make that work. And so it's amazing to me, not only IT, we want to double the size of our IT overnight, but the number of mathematicians that just need to grind these numbers on a daily basis. And so the world of finance, yeah, they're gonna need you. They don't need you as much as I do. We need you to fix football and make football better, because finally owners and coaches and general managers are understanding and knowing what they didn't know. I'm beginning to understand what I didn't know about the game. And I love being wrong about football, as long as it's on Monday and Tuesday and not at the end of the week. So I'm looking for people to help me be right on Sunday and fix my errors on Monday and Tuesday. And we would love to answer questions. We'd love to spend some time with any of you that might have an interest in this sort of work. I'm telling you, Neil, have you ever gone to work a day in your life?
Well, not since I started. I used to work an awful lot,
yeah,
Chris,
But it's a wonderful way to make a living, and we're really, really appreciative of the fact that we were invited here. And any kind of questions you have, we'd love to ask. Yeah.
I'm a finance guy, so it's a little bit difficult to ask a question. But
Let's
say you have a backup, so how do you actually get to the grade? So I understand the model, but do you watch video? Do you have people watching video and scoring them by hand?
Yes. Yeah, we do it by hand. We've got about 350 people spread, obviously, mostly throughout the US. We have a cloud-based system in which they input that data. They input most of it live, and then we go back. We do one pass. Another guy does another pass. We have coaches, the Pro Coach Network. They do a pass as well. These are guys with about 15 years, average experience of NFL coaching. And then we pull all that together. That gives us the final raw grades, as I was explaining. And then we do all the mathematical normalization for the quality of the opportunity on top. But it's essentially at root. It's a manual process.
But there was a time that one guy had to do all of it. And now with the new data acquisition tool, you can have 20 people from around the country and around the world inputting data into the same system to come up with a grade. Yes, sir. All the time. Yeah.
So how can you individually determine, so say, you know, a pass rusher's going in and he gets an easy pass to the quarterback, and maybe that's because an offensive line wasn't doing his job. So how can you kind of individualize each performance so that it's not dependent on other players' moves in the same way? I know the grades are individual. It seems somehow that each player's performance is also dependent on what's going on.
Well, I think that we have much better evaluations and grades than the National Football League does, because the National Football League will tell you that pass was complete or incomplete, right? If Aaron, the biggest fight we had probably in my history since I've been there, Aaron Rodgers won game through 5 touchdown passes and no interceptions, and we had him as kind of a zero grade, as not really being good or bad. And everything, it all broke loose on this day. I mean, it was crazy. But he had 3 touchdown passes where he completed a screen pass or a ball in the flat that he doesn't get any credit for. He had 2 balls in the game that he threw basically right in the chest of a defender that we count as interceptions. So we are telling you what should have happened, what could have happened on the play, instead of what did happen. And so that can cause some real issues. But at the end, we at least believe you're much closer to the truth than what you are based on just statistics.
Yeah. The bottom line on that is we don't grade on the result of the play. Sometimes the result of the play is just happenstance. It's fluke. We grade on what should have happened on the play and what the quarterback threw. If the quarterback throws a 2-yard pass to the halfback who then breaks 5 tackles, why is the quarterback getting the benefit of that?
He does under the systems.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
How do you take into consideration when you get the offensive lineman the raw grade? In your normalization process, do you take into consideration how hard of a matchup it is, and how skilled the defensive player is that's trying to get around him? Is he average? Is he above average, below average?
We don't. And we've gone into this many times and we've thought about it. We prefer to do that after the grade is published. So I prefer to look down, and I always used to do this. Robert Quinn, Robert Quinn, the pass rusher for St. Louis? When he was in his heyday, I always used to look down at Robert Quinn's grades, and I used to look against every single tackle that he was going against. And the thing with Robert Quinn that you could pick out was he would make hay against the worst tackles in the league. But when he played anybody even remotely good, what you would consider above average, he got nothing. Now, there's a benefit, there's an absolute benefit to killing people who are bad, that no question. But I want to know that. So I prefer it that I look down and look at the people he's gone against and then do that. That said, the new stuff that we were doing that I'm talking about, the all blocking that allows us to do every single matchup, will allow us to do exactly that calculation at a level of accuracy that I will feel much more comfortable with. So we will do it going forward, but we haven't done it in the past for some of the reasons that we've talked about.
Sir. Yeah.
Do you feel that your process is replicable for a sport like soccer or maybe hockey where other analytics tools aren't as accurate as
you? Probably.
You would be blown away by the new tool that's being built right now. So the interesting thing, and I won't tell you the number, but we had a guy put an extraordinary number on the value of our company who's been involved in data his whole life. And his thing was that you will not believe what people do with your data. But Neil's data goes back 10 years, mm-hmm. 10 years now. And so the depth and breadth of that data will now become attached. The guy was telling me he was involved in AC Nielsen, who did the television ratings. And he said, I would have never in a million years imagined that my television ratings would have had something to do with where Coca-Cola is placed in a grocery store. He said, everybody, every company is gonna have their own guys from MIT and Harvard and Princeton and Yale and Stanford that are gonna find ways to use the data. His thing was lock the data down. Make the data as great and as deep as it possibly can. So Neil and his team not only go the next year, oftentimes they go a year back. So we're gaining 2 years oftentimes instead of just one. So now the data set, there's nobody out there, whether it's the NFL, there's nobody out there that has that layer of data on which to do analytics. So that's the great advantage that we have, that somebody else may begin to do it. So could we do it for other sports? I think that we can, but you would, again, want to go both directions to get the depth of the data. Back in the back.
I'll need Nathan to come up with some sage if you want me to go statistical on you. One of the key things is that we've tried to do with our data, and one of my beliefs from the start was, if you don't complete the pass at the start, you don't get into the red zone at the end of the day. So it's one thing to say, yes, we need to complete in the red zone, but you've got to get to the red zone first. Well, how do you get to the red zone? Is it more important that you don't complete the pass on third down and at least kick a field goal when you're in the red zone, that you don't complete the pass on the 45 on your own 45-yard line that would have taken you into the red zone to start with? So this is a personal view, but I'm not as enamored with red zone stats as some people are.
The only thing I'll say about that is that there's two different games. There's a game between the 20s and there's a game from the 20 in. Because think about it, when you're in a zone defense and you're on the opposing 20-yard line, you have 80 yards of field, that zone gets stretched over 80 yards, right? I mean, that has to be a big, wide thing. Now those same eight people in a 30-yard space, 20 yards and 10 yards of the end zone, are greatly shrunk down, and the holes are tiny. And that's when so many times you'll see young quarterbacks that can move the ball between the 20s, but they can't score touchdowns. And the Tom Brady's and the Aaron Rodgers and the Peyton Manning's of the world, that's where you see the differentiation of the great ones. Sir.
Really interesting, and it's something that we're going to go and do. You know, we built the new system in such a way that we can go back and do any game. I don't know whether if some of you guys follow us, you'll know that we went back and did all of the Patriots Super Bowls just before the Super Bowl, and we graded them all. And we've been going back. One of the things is we train our new analysts by, I don't believe in throwing data away. So we train our new analysts by doing a season. We did 2006 last year. Don't worry, it's not just done by random analysts. Our big guys then come and check them all and make sure it's all right. But we go back and we'll do 2005 and we'll do 2004. And, you know, I'm sure over the course of time, we'll get involved in those Hall of Fame debates. But the most important thing, and I want to say it for our NFL customers here, that it's a really important point. We do a production metric. We do a metric that is how that player is playing right now. We don't take into account injury. We don't take into account, at the moment, who is faced. to a greater degree. We don't take into account his talent level. So one of the bigger issues, it's not a bigger issue, but it's one of the disconnects to some degree between us and our customers that when I explain it, they understand is that's a production metric. So because we've got this guy graded here this year and you've got him here, we're not comparing apples and apples because you're taking into account what you know of him as a player, the fact of how he's played over his entire career, what his talent level is, and we're telling you how he played this year. And those are two disparate things.
I would love to stay here all day. If I don't get on this flight, my wife is going to divorce me three times over here, and I do not want that to happen. So I'm going to have to check out. But we greatly, greatly appreciate the fact that you guys came. Thank you very much.